earlier in the course, we introduced you to the singular value decomposition. Now, for the algebraic eigenvalue problem, the Schur decomposition is sort of the equivalent of the singular value decomposition. It is just as big of a result in linear algebra. And what is that result? Well, it says that given any matrix A, any m by m matrix A, you can always find a unitary matrix Q and an upper triangular matrix U such that A can be written as the product of Q times that upper triangular matrix times the Hermitian transpose of Q, which of course is the inverse of Q. Okay, this turns out to be huge. We love unitary matrices, right? So what it really means is that any matrix A is similar to an upper triangular matrix. And we saw earlier that finding the eigenvalues of an upper triangular matrix is easy. You just read them off on the diagonal. So this is good news. How do we prove this? Well, given any matrix A, it's at least a 1x1 matrix. I guess we have encountered empty matrices in this course, but let's not go there. Given any matrix A, we know that it has at least one eigenvalue. And therefore, we know that we can find a vector x that is a non-zero vector such that A times x is equal to lambda x. Okay. And we actually can do slightly better. We can say, let's take that vector of length 1. And let's call it Q1. Right? Because we can always take our vector x and normalize it to be of length 1, and we just get another eigenvector associated with lambda. Now, what we can then do is do exactly the kind of trick that we did when we talked about the singular value decomposition, and we can take that vector Q, make it the first column in a unitary matrix where we will call the rest of that matrix Q2. Okay? Now, if we hit matrix A on the left with the Hermitian transpose of that matrix and on the right with the matrix itself, well, that's sort of like what we want to do here, except that we bring Q Hermitian transpose to this side and Q to that side, right? So this is in the right direction. If we can show that the result of this is upper triangular, we'd be done. But, you know, we're not that lucky yet. We're not that good at just magically picking Q2. This here is equal to Q1 Hermitian transpose, Q2 Hermitian transpose, times matrix A, and let's actually go ahead and multiply this out. And this would be A times Q1, and then A times Q2. Okay, and we know how to do partition matrix multiplication. This is just an outer product with partition matrices, and therefore this is equal to Q1 Hermitian transpose A Q1, Q1 Hermitian transpose A Q2, Q2 Hermitian transpose A Q1, and Q2 Hermitian A Q2. Now, A times Q1 is just lambda times Q1. And Q1 Hermitian transpose times Q1, the dot product of Q1 with itself, is just the square of its length, but its length we chose to be 1. So this here becomes lambda. Okay. Similarly, this right here becomes lambda times Q1. But a scalar we can always bring to the front. And notice that we chose all of these columns in Q2 to be orthonormal to Q1, or orthogonal to Q1, and therefore this right here is 0, and therefore we end up with the 0 vector right here. Now this is just some vector, we can call it whatever we want, W transpose, some row. And this is just some matrix. And then you can see that maybe we can move forward with this project, this process, and make this submatrix right here eventually upper triangular. And through a proof by induction, you would then get there. And just like when we talked about the singular value decomposition and we accumulated unitary matrices, you can accumulate the unitary matrices into the final Q that we really wanted. Okay, so this is not the actual Q that we want. We probably should have put little checks on here just to distinguish these Qs from the final Q that we're after. And bingo, here we have the Schur decomposition theorem.